Well, how about this, guys? Look at this. Oh my goodness, has it been a minute since we have done a whiteboard video on the channel? And here we are today. We're gonna go through three stock market traps to avoid. And these three things are relevant right now in the market, but they're also relevant in the future, okay? And these three traps I see people come across all the time, okay? You know, having, you know, the main channel I have, right? Financial Education, and then obviously having this channel, Financial Education 3, I get to see people coming through the stock market all the time. Stock Hub, right? Which is our free Discord chat. Always get to see people in there, right? The private Discord chat, and along with like Instagram DMs and all these different ways, I get to see like traps people are getting into in the market, okay? And there's definitely some that we're gonna go through, okay? One's called two guys walk into a Toyota dealership. Get ready for that one, okay? One's called two guys walk into the stock market, and the improper use of the L. Okay, and so we'll go through all these, and yeah, I think this is going to be a video a ton of you guys get a ton of value from. And all I ask for in return is that you smash that thumbs up button if you haven't already. And if you're a loyal watcher, you probably already smashed by now because you love the whiteboard video. These don't come that often, okay? But every once in a while, I gotta bust out the whiteboard. I had to dust it off and whatnot and get it ready. If you're looking to join us in the private stock group and you want to join in there, or you want to check it out, you want to apply to join there, things like that, check out the first pinned comment in the comment section. If you're looking to join our brand new value email list that's absolutely free to sign up for, check out the second pinned comment down there. Alrighty guys, let's get into this, okay? First one up here, two guys walk into a Toyota dealership, okay? Let's say we have a scenario, okay? And let's say all of us, you know, me and all you guys watching this right now, let's say we're all sitting somehow in a Toyota dealership, which would be hard because I'm sure a lot of people will watch this video. That would be a little difficult, but let's pretend we're all sitting around and seating at this Toyota dealership and we're just watching customers come in, right? We're watching these customers come in, talk to the, you know, the sales representatives there at this Toyota dealership, okay? And we're watching this happen. Okay, and this guy comes in, okay, and he's very, very well informed. He's talking about, you know, what he thinks this Toyota Corolla should be worth. He takes it for a test drive. He's done his research. He knows everything about this Toyota Corolla, okay, and he wants it. He likes it, okay. He's done his research work. He's well informed, and we're all impressed. We're like, hey, man, this guy gets it, okay. Then he goes to negotiate for that Toyota Corolla, and he negotiates hard on it. He knows, like, what's a realistic price he can get it for. He knows what's a completely unrealistic price, and he ends up working out a deal for this Toyota Corolla. And we're like, you know, applauding him. We're like, hey man, you know, he didn't get taken by the dealership. He got a pretty fair price on that Toyota Corolla today. Good for him. He should have bought a Model 3, but he bought a Corolla, okay? So we won't judge him too much, all right? So we see that guy, and we're like, woo, good for you, man. Then, all of a sudden, another guy comes in. He's like, hey, I need a Toyota Corolla. How much? $100,000. And sales guy's like, well, you know, Toyota Corolla is only worth $30,000 in his head. But he's like, hey, yeah, $100,000? No, we'll sell it to you for $200,000. He's like, okay, $200,000. Yeah, I need that Toyota Corolla, okay? And he's so jacked up, right? He's like, I've got FOMO all over the place. He's like, I need this Toyota Corolla, right? He's completely uneducated. And all of us are sitting back and we're like, dude, that Toyota Corolla is worth like $25,000 or $30,000 or whatever. Like, what are you doing paying that price for it, right? In the real world, that's completely unacceptable, right? It's completely unacceptable for that guy to pay some ridiculous price for that Toyota Corolla. Or imagine, you know, somebody's going into a McDonald's and they're like, I'm gonna pay $1,000 for that Big Mac, okay? We're like, dude, that Big Mac's worth like $4, okay? And it's barely worth $4, okay? Like, what are you doing, okay? And this guy's like, I'll pay $1,000 for a Big Mac, right? We understand in the real world, right, that that is ridiculous. You don't do that. You don't act like that. That's not the way you do this thing, okay? But in the stock market, something's different, okay? And it comes down to valuation. In the real world, we understand what a product is worth, a service is worth, right? If we've done our research work. But in the stock market all the time, people think it's completely acceptable to have no clue how to value a stock. And they end up buying stocks that they have no clue if they're getting a good price for, a great price for, the deal of the century on it, an okay price, a bad price, or paying a ridiculous overvaluation for it.
And that's the stock market.
And if somebody like myself that's been doing this for over a decade now, I look at that and I say, that's ridiculous. It's ridiculous, but it happens all the time. People don't know how to value stocks, and they will buy stocks at whatever price. They will buy it at whatever price, man. And at the end of the day, okay, the end of the day, valuation matters, okay? Valuation matters. In the short term, valuation doesn't matter. Valuations can go crazy. Any stock out there in a snap of fingers can go crazy, okay? I don't know, just an immense amount of buying pressure goes in it. A short squeeze happens, a gamma squeeze. Like, you can get all types of crazy situations that happen in the stock market, right? That push a valuation sky high in the short term. And with any stock out there, it can happen at any moment's notice, right? It doesn't matter if it's a smaller cap company, like a $100 million company, right? Or if it's a $1 billion market cap or $10 billion. I've seen them all fly like, you know, crazy, right? Doesn't really matter. But you know what does matter? Valuation always matters in the long term. It always matters. If you don't know a fair trailing 12-month PE and a fair forward PE and what a growth rate is for a company and why a company deserves a certain multiple on it based upon where their growth is or price to sales ratio, if you're comparing on that, if you don't know these things, you don't know how to do these things, then you might be the guy at the Toyota dealership walking in there paying $100,000 for a Toyota Corolla, okay? You don't wanna be that guy. Be the guy that got it for a fair price, okay? But all the time, people think it's okay to pay whatever price for a stock, and that's not the way that works. What that's gonna end up doing, if you get into this trap where you're paying any price for a stock, what that will end up doing is it's gonna end up making you lose a bunch of money, right? Because you paid a way overvalued valuation, the valuation has to come down, and you lose a ton of money, right? Or you're gonna have limited gains, because if a stock is already trading at some ridiculous valuation, right? Now there's limited upside to that stock, right? I'll give a good example of a stock, my best stock ever, right? Tesla, my Tesla, right? When I was buying Tesla, my Tesla in 2019 for, you know, $30 million market cap, $40 million market cap, whatever, right? I mean, that was a really good deal I was getting, in my opinion, at that time, right? Then over the next, you know, year and a half, 2 years, the stock goes from a $30 to $40 million market cap all the way up to, at its peak, I think it was maybe $850 billion market cap, okay? And so $850 billion, I don't know, man, that valuation's getting stretched, right? Definitely getting stretched up there, right? Yeah, especially where Tesla's at right now and even where they're going over the next few years. But when I was buying at 30, 40 billion, it's the deal of the century. So it went from deal of the century to, whoa, that's quite a hefty valuation there, right? In a very short amount of time. That happens in the stock market, and that happens with stocks. And that's why you can get some great companies that don't have their stock price move for a long time, right? Remember Tesla. Tesla's an example of a stock that stock did nothing for like 5 or 6 years because it shot up to a ridiculous valuation. I remember looking at Tesla, and I think it was either 2013 or 2014, and I thought, wow, cool company, got some cool stuff going on, but my goodness, is that company trading at a silly high valuation, okay? And then the stock didn't do anything for years and years and years, okay? Because it needed to come in line, the growth needed to get back up, and then it was silly that it took so long for it to start moving, okay? Valuation matters. Two guys walk into the stock market. The first man that walks into the stock market, he walks in, he's prepared, he knows what he's doing, he knows what he's looking for, he's done his research work, right? And he starts looking at stocks, starts finding some stocks that he feels are a fair value or undervalue. He starts buying those stocks. He starts building out a portfolio over the next few years of a diversified, good set of companies that he really believes in a lot for the long term. He buys some growth stocks, he buys some value stocks, he buys some dividend plays, he buys a spec stock or two, okay? And he builds out this portfolio that he loves, okay? Meanwhile, the other man walks into the stock market, okay? And he says, man, you know, what if it crashes? What if the stock market crashes? Well, we might have reached a record. Maybe it's gonna crash now. And he's always on the sideline, just with this crash. Like, oh, what if the stock market crashes? What if we have a stock market crash? And he's always on the sideline, okay? And this is one of the biggest traps I see investors get into all the time, where they don't participate in the market or they're scared to participate in the market because, quote unquote, it might crash, okay? Guess what?
The stock market will crash from time to time. We're gonna have corrections from time to time. You have to accept that, okay? At the end of the day, it's not worth it to try to time it out. I've watched countless people over the years try to time this out. Well, it might crash, so I don't know if I wanna buy right now. Let me wait a little while. I'm telling you, it is not even worth your time to worry about if the stock market crashes, what's the stock market gonna crash? Because whenever it does happen, you won't even know what's going on, okay? It'll happen so fast and it's gonna come out of nowhere, you won't even know. Just like the Roni Rona situation, right? No one could have predicted that stock market crash, right? And the reason no one could have predicted it because we had a once in a 100-year health event out of nowhere shut down the global economy, right? And we had the fastest stock market crash in the history of the stock market, if I recall. I think it was a 35% drop in the market, the S&P 500, and what was it, 22 trading days? 22 trading days. Unbelievable. Absolutely unbelievable. And who could have seen that coming, right? Like, no one could have seen that coming. So at the end of the day, it's not even worth your time to worry about when the stock market's gonna crash, when's a big recession coming, or things like that. It, you know, because it's like, even if you think something's gonna happen, all of a sudden the Fed steps in, and all of a sudden they lower interest rates, all of a sudden they pump money out there. What if stimulus checks come, right? I mean, the stock market crash of 2020 could have got a lot worse. We could have seen that stock market down 50% plus easily. I mean, we could have hit 60, 70% down instead of 35% down. We could have, okay? And troughed somewhere in there. But we didn't. Why? Because the Fed stepped in. It sloshed money out there, right? Stimulus checks, lower interest rates, make sure, you know, banks are super well capitalized, everything across the board. The Fed stepped in there, so we do everything to keep this market going and to keep the economy out of a situation where it was like gonna be a Great Depression or something like that, right? They did everything in their power. And so this is why it is not even worth it. It is not worth it. Because you know what happens? The majority of years, the stock market goes up, okay? In the majority of years, stocks go up. And you, especially if you're an individual stock picker, where you're actually picking individual stocks, right? The beautiful thing about picking individual stocks is you can find deals all over the place. Regardless of market, you can outperform the market, right? You get into the right stock here and the right stock there. And so that's why the name of the game is focus on stocks, focus on individual stocks, in my opinion, because that's where the real money's made. You're never gonna make any money just worrying about a crash all the time or something like that, okay? So yeah, don't fall into this trap. It will lose you a lot of gains. So now this last one is very, very important, okay? And this is something that it's gonna, if what I'm gonna talk about here in the third point, if it's not hitting you right now, there's a good probability what I'm about to say over the next few minutes in regards to this will matter to you at some point in time, okay? And so this is one of those parts of the video, like, make sure you remember what I'm about to say in the third part here, because I can promise you, if you're in this market long enough, it's gonna end up eventually one day creeping up, and you're gonna look at this and you're gonna think, maybe I'm gonna utilize this. And if you don't know how to utilize it, and you don't know what's the proper way of doing it and how you should and why you should, you're gonna get yourself into some real trouble. I can promise you that, okay? And you don't wanna do that. This is something that can definitely help you get make more money in the stock market, but it can also help you lose a lot of money in the stock market, okay? And what this one is it is the improper use of leverage. The improper use of leverage, okay? Or otherwise known as margin. And there are three big points I wanna make here in regards to margin that I don't think a lot of people realize. And I wanna make sure folks realize this so you understand if you are gonna use margin, if you're improperly using margin, okay? So, when it comes to margin, if you don't know what that is, it's essentially taking out debt to invest more money in stocks. So let's say I have a stock market account with, you know, $1 million in it, right? I can have another margin of $1 million. Sometimes you can actually even margin a little more than that. So I could actually have debt of over $1 million, right? So I have my $1 million I can invest here, plus another $1 million over here, right? And you could see, like, wow, if you do really good at stocks, wow, you can make a lot more money in the market. And that's the exciting part. That's the exciting part and the allure of margin, because it's like, man, I can leverage my money, I can make way more money, right? No different than a real estate investor looks at, you know, real estate investment properties and says, man, I can leverage money, right? I can get into the next property, and I can get those cash flows building, right? A stock market investor says, I can use this leverage and go ahead and make more gains from stocks, okay? But the problem is people improperly use it. So first off, if you're newer to the market, don't go near margin, man. You're not there yet, okay? I don't care if you happen to get a 48% return in the market last year and you're looking at your margin and you're like, oh, I could take out margin for 6%, 4%, blah, blah, blah. No. Okay. I would say, you know, in my opinion, okay, in order to use margin, I think there's a few requirements. I think you need a minimum of 3 years in the market, okay? And I'm talking 3 serious years, maybe even 5 serious years. Not like you kind of played around with some stocks here and there. I'm talking about taking this stuff serious, okay? A minimum of 3 years. You also need to have a job of some kind or a business or active income, okay? I made a big mistake in 2015 where I was margining out money without a job, okay, at that particular time. Not a good decision, because then you're gonna put yourself in a bad situation where if your stocks tank and you get a little over margined and you have no cash flow incoming, you get margin calls. And margin calls is when your brokerage says, hey, Johnny, you need to deposit some money into your account or sell some stocks because you gotta bring your margin rate down because you're too high on margin, you're getting a margin call, okay? And if you don't do it in a certain amount of time, the brokerage has the right to actually liquidate positions from your portfolio, okay? They have that right. When you sign up that waiver, okay, they have the right that if you get a margin call and you don't do what you're supposed to do, either put more money in or sell off some stocks to bring down the margin rate, they have the right to sell that stock on your behalf, okay? And not a lot of people read the fine print to even understand that, okay? Very, very important, okay? So I would say you need income of some kind, whether that's your own business or maybe you got a bunch of different real estate investment properties, something like that. At least 3 years of serious being in the market, okay? Now, it's not just that. Let's say you have this stuff, okay? The other issue is going overboard with the margin, right? And putting yourself into a situation, this is an issue with margin, okay? Let's say we go back to the example. You got a $1 million account, you have at least $1 million in margin you can take out, okay? The problem is, what happens to a lot of folks, especially if they're newer to margin, is they say, okay, I'll just start out with $100,000 margin, okay? So I got $1 million over here, and I got $100,000 on debt. And so they start out like that, right? And everything's fine. And then all of a sudden they see another stock they like and they're like, let me buy another $200,000 on margin. And it'll only put me up to $300,000 on margin. I still got $1 million over here. And then some of their stocks start tanking, right? And then, you know, all of a sudden their account balance goes down to $800,000 in their own money. They got $300K on margin. And they're like, well, there's some deals over there, so let me buy another $200,000 over here. Now all of a sudden, they have $500,000 in margin debt and $800,000 in their portfolio. Next thing you know, they drop some more. They drop down to $700,000, right? And they see these deals and like, I can't miss out on these deals. I'm gonna buy another $200,000. Next thing you know, now they have as much in debt on margin debt as they do actual like equity in their portfolio, right? And this is how it happens. And the next thing you know, all of a sudden they're stuck in a situation where potential margin calls can come, okay? And so this is why if you're going margin, you have to be extremely disciplined. I mean extremely disciplined. And it's hard, especially when you're a newer investor in the market, right? And this is why I say you should definitely have some time in the market before you even consider something like this, right? Because all of a sudden you see some stocks tank and then you want to buy more and you're like, I don't really have any more cash around, but I can margin out some more money. And next thing you know, you're getting into the situation where, oh my gosh, you all of a sudden, you know, all of a sudden next thing you know, you're like, wait a minute, now I have more margin debt than I do actually my own money. And that can happen in a portfolio. Sometimes they'll let you go over 100%, right? And so it makes for just a messy situation. And so then when it comes to improper use of margin in the last part here, this is essentially a part where people aren't really paying close enough attention to the interest rate, okay? The IR they have to pay on margin. Now here's the issue. Here's the big issue, okay? You have somebody in the market, right? And this happened to me in 2014 and 2015, right? I was getting 30 to 40% gains consistently year after year after year after year, right? So I quit at Quick Trip and I say, okay, let me just start doing margin, right? Well, margin interest rate Fidelity wanted to start me at that time back then, because I only had about $200,000 in my brokerage back then, okay? So what they were gonna start me at was, it was I think 7%. Somewhere around there roughly. I don't know, maybe 6%, 7%, 8%, somewhere in there. So let's say 6 to 8, okay? I looked at that and I said, okay, 6 to 8%, it seems a little high, but here I am getting 30 to 40% year after year after year, knocking the ball out of the ballpark. Who cares? 6 to 8%, that's like a joke to me. I'm getting 30 to 40%, okay? So that's the way I looked at it. Not the way to look at it, man. You don't look at whatever returns you got last year, the year before to judge if you're getting a good margin interest rate, okay? I'm telling you guys, like, you know, if we're talking 6% plus, in my opinion, it's not even worth looking at it, okay? If we're talking 6% plus, because here's how I view it, okay? The market in general goes up around 8% per year, right? That's on average. But sometimes the stock market doesn't go up, right? And keep in mind, you could do worse than the market does, right? And keep in mind, right, you have to pay taxes if you take out gains. And, you know, there's a decent probability if you're doing some margin stuff, maybe you're getting into some shorter term activities and you're maybe buying and selling a little more than somebody else. And so all of a sudden you're paying short term gains on that. You got to pay taxes on that. So that's the way I kind of think about it, okay? And so if it's 6% or more, I wouldn't even consider it, okay? Where it can start to at least become consideration, in my opinion, is 4% or under, okay? 4% or under, if you have the experience and you've been doing this for a long time and you can stay disciplined and you have income streams, then it's at least worth consideration. Now, to some folks, it still might not be worth consideration because some folks don't know how to control it. So we're assuming you know how to control yourself, right? You're mature enough in the market, you have experience, you have income streams, and you're not gonna go overboard, right? At 4% or under, it's in consideration, right? I do some margin from time to time. I've been in the market for a very long time. I have multiple income streams, and I always keep a ton of cash on the sideline. And on top of that, I negotiated with Fidelity for 1.55% margin interest rate, okay? So to somebody like myself, it can make sense, right? I got a lot of cash I keep around. I have multiple income streams. I've been doing this in the market on a serious level for well over a decade now. And I got 1.55%. It's worth it for me if I want to dabble in some margin, to dabble in some margin, okay? But for a lot of other folks out there, man, they get themselves into a lot of trouble and they put themselves under a lot of stress, and I've been there, okay? And that's not a fun situation to be in, okay? So hope you guys enjoyed this video today. Hope you got a ton of value out of it. As always, whiteboard video here. If you didn't already, smash that thumbs up button. That's all I ask for in return. If you're looking to take your investing to the next level, you wanna learn either from me or from our coaches. We actually have one-on-one coaching if you're looking for something like that, right? Check out the main pinned comment down there in the comment section. If you want to join our value email list, check out the second pinned comment down there. Thank you for watching and have a great day.